From a shadowy figure walking in front of an oncoming train, to traumatizing events resulting from playing with a Ouija board, these are four bone-chilling and allegedly true supernatural horror stories. I am Fearcrawler. Welcome to the video. This story took place about 6 months ago. My friend and I were having a sleepover at his house. We would do the normal stuff like hang out, play video games, and watch TV. So, my friend, we'll call him Mitchell, had wanted to go to this abandoned house down the street from his neighborhood. I was curious, so I said yes. We made it to the house and the entire front was gone. Just destroyed. It was nighttime, so we had to use our flashlights on our phones for light. We started searching inside the house, but it was nothing like I had expected. We did find an unopened cabinet inside, and when we opened it, we found a Ouija board inside of it. Of course, Mitchell and I were being kind of stupid, so we decided to take it back to his house and try it out. The thing is, I've never really believed in spirits or ghosts. We set up the Ouija board and lit a bunch of candles that Mitchell's mom had. She was out of town for a whole week, so we just decided to use them. We put the pointer on the board and we asked if anyone was there. The pointer moved to yes. Mitchell and I were shocked, and we asked if there was anything we could do to help. The pointer moved again, and it spelled out two words that said, knife. And cut. I felt the sharp blade run down my hand, and then I realized that my hand was bleeding. Mitchell and I were so freaked out that we didn't even realize what was happening. We put our hands back on the pointer and asked, "Why did you cut me?" The pointer then moved, and it spelled out two more words. House fire. After that, I grabbed a knife from the kitchen, and I cut the board in half. Not even 10 seconds after that, Mitchell and I heard a big explosion. We were curious what it was, so we went outside and started following the smoke. To our surprise, it was coming from the abandoned house that we found the Ouija board in. A neighbor was already outside calling the fire department, and we decided to stay there until they arrived. After they did, Mitchell and I went back to his house. When we walked back to his room, the Ouija board was right back on the table. The pointer moved by itself and spelled the word, run. As soon as it did this, I could feel a cold hand grab my chin. Just as soon as I felt it, I was pushed into a wall and I couldn't move. Then Mitchell was grabbed by the foot and was hanged upside down. But we couldn't see anyone. It was a ghost. Then I heard something whisper in my ear saying, "Destroy the board." As soon as it said that, Mitchell and I were both let go, and we immediately destroyed the board. As soon as we destroyed it, I threw the board into the sewer and I went back inside the house. I will never, ever play with a Ouija board again. This happened to me and my cousin a few years back. I was babysitting for my aunt and I had just put my cousin to sleep. I turned around and began walking down the hall into the living room. I had just sat down when I heard my cousin screaming. I stood up and walked into the room where she was sleeping. I saw her crying. I asked her why she was crying. She said a word that sounded like boogeyman. "There's no boogeyman," I said. "Just go to sleep." I left and 20 minutes later this happened again. I went into the room and she was still crying. Then I heard the crash coming from inside the closet. My aunt's closet door began rattling. It was a big walk-in closet with a door and everything. The handle began turning back and forth and the door finally opened a crack. I picked up my cousin and we ran into my older cousin's room. I never told my aunt what happened. Even if I wanted to tell her, I wouldn't even know where to begin. I need to give you a little background on the situation my sister and I were in before I begin the story. I was having a hard time after September 11th of 2001. I had lost my job and got behind on a few bills, and I ended up sharing a small apartment with my sister who was also having a hard time catching up. We were feeling down and out in life, doing drugs and other things that we really shouldn't have been doing. We were definitely going down the wrong path. It was Halloween night 2003. All the trick-or-treaters had gone in for the evening. My sister and I realized that we didn't have anything in the house to drink, so we decided to go down to the corner store. We got our coats on and headed down the street, discussing where our lives were headed and how we needed to change the way we were living. Before we knew it, we were at the store. We went in and got our drinks and headed back home. On our way back home, we continued our conversation. We walked about two blocks and the both of us got a really eerie feeling. I looked up and saw a large being coming towards us. It was about 6.5 feet tall. It was wearing a large top hat. It also had on a long black trench coat like the one that Jack the Ripper wore. We were a little bit creeped out, but we decided to keep walking, a little more cautious in our strides. As we got closer to the being, more and more detail came into focus. It had long, white, wiry hair. Its arms and legs were out of proportion with the rest of its body. I then looked at its hands and realized that they too were extra long and thin, its fingers long and bony. It seemed to radiate pure evil. There was no way I could see its face or features that it had, due to the top hat shading its face in the night. My sister and I were now really freaked out. There was no way we could get to the gate of our complex before it reached us. Its pace seemed to quicken as we got closer and closer to it. It almost seemed to glide across the ground in an unearthly gait. My sister grabbed my shoulder and pulled me through a gap in the fence. Safely on the other side of the fence, we glanced back. A few moments later, the being was there. It passed us with almost no acknowledgement except a slight movement of its head, as if to show its discontent in our escape. My sister and I, although shaken, headed home with an eager pace. The next morning, I awoke with the events of the night before vividly in my mind. The more I thought about it, I realized that I didn't remember there ever being a gap in the fence before. I had walked all around the complex, and the only openings in the fence were the entrance gates. I just thought that maybe the apartments had been doing maintenance on the fence, so I went to check. There weren't any gaps large enough for an adult to squeeze through, so I went to the office to ask them. They looked at me as if I were crazy and told me they hadn't done any maintenance on the fence in at least 6 months. I just thank God for giving us an out, and not allowing this thing to overtake my sister and I. Shortly after the events of that Halloween night, we quit doing drugs and we turned our lives around. I truly think the events of that night was a wake-up call for us. It was a divine way of telling us that we were going down the wrong path. This happened to my husband back in 2007 on Halloween night. My husband called me to tell me as soon as this happened, and it's been boggling his mind ever since. He works for the railroad, and one night while on the train going south, he and his engineer passed through a small county, something he's done for 5 years, when something caught their attention. Up ahead, my husband saw someone lying on the tracks, and he told the engineer to slam on the brakes. The engineer saw the guy too, so he pulled the emergency brakes. But, of course, it takes about a mile for a train going 70 miles per hour to slow down. What they both saw was an older man with a beard, who was lying on his side facing the train. When the man saw the train as it got close, he put up both his hands in a defensive manner, and he had a frightened look on his face. Before they knew it, they slammed into the guy. and the train finally stopped. My husband and the engineer were shaken up, and my husband called his manager to tell him what had happened. He told them to call the local authorities and state troopers and so on. After everyone had showed up and they finally looked under the train, there was nothing. Nothing at all. My husband and the engineer were embarrassed because everyone was there to investigate, and there was nothing under the train. They swore that they had ran over the guy because they heard the thumping sounds as the train kept going. They walked back to the point of impact, and there was nothing. No blood, no clothes, no shoes. They called in the canines, but they couldn't pick up a scent. If they had hit someone and he ran off, there would have been blood or something, and I'm sure he wouldn't have gone very far. The local cops had told my husband and the engineer that there were a bunch of kids throwing mannequins off this bridge, so it was most likely just a mannequin. But that was impossible because of what they saw. So who knows what happened that night. My husband isn't much of a believer, and he isn't frightened by anything like this, or ghost stories for that matter. But it does make me wonder. That's all for today's video. I do hope you enjoyed. Be sure to tell me what you thought in the comment section below. Until next time, everyone take care, be safe, and above all, stay scared.